Croak and Crow is a brand. It's an idea. It's a way of life.
It's ours.
Hello and welcome back to the Croak and Crow podcast, episode number 1515. Okay? It's good to be here. You know what we do here. We talk about spiritual things, religious things, however we want to talk about them. Okay? I'm Spencer.
I'm Verona.
We got two special announcements. I'll start with the first one. If you follow our Instagram page, at Croak and Crow, you already know this. If you don't, shame on you, but I'll tell you anyway. So first, I just want to say that Croak and Crow is not just a podcast. The Croak and Crow podcast, that's a podcast. But Croak and Crow is a brand. It's an idea. It's a way of life.
It's ours.
It's a brand. Yeah, it's...
It's not a chain.
And so we are going to go down many paths under the name Croak and Crow. And the one I'm excited about is a van build. I've recently acquired...
This is where we need the...
A 2006 Dodge Sprinter. And we're going to convert it. I'm going to video the conversion. We're going to post it. It's going to be the Croak and Crow van build. I'm very excited about it. You should be excited about it. It's going to be fun. We'll see where it takes us. I don't know what I'm doing, but I'll figure it out. I got the Lord on my side.
That's right.
He'll guide me the right way.
Because already he put it in your life. He made it appear and it was accessible.
It just appeared. Got out of bed today. I looked outside and there's a van.
We're pretty sure we can have it.
Yeah.
No, but it was not something that.
No, yeah. So we're super excited about it.
And thankful.
And hopefully it's not the end all be all. Hopefully Croak and Crow branches out to a million things. But the next big thing is the van build. Conversion to a camper.
A little sprout to a giant oak.
Yes, exactly. And so now, do you have a little announcement?
Well, it's the 15th episode.
15.
And we're so proud to have gotten there and so happy and grateful that the Holy Spirit gave us something to talk about 14 other times. And I like the number 15 because my twins were born on the number 15. That was a double blessing. So we promised you a special surprise. The van is your surprise, but it's going to be their surprise. But the surprise for today is, as Spencer's talking, I'm going to paint something that I'm inspired to paint because of what happens during this 15th podcast. Never did this before.
Probably will turn out great.
Probably. And so, also, maybe there's three surprises today.
Ooh.
Because the one surprise you don't know is the theme, because you never know the theme.
I never know the theme.
And the theme is finally...
Yes.
It's finally.
Yes.
Exercise.
Oh, man. Boy, oh, boy. Okay, well, sit down. Actually, pause the video. Grab popcorn. Go to the bathroom.
Yeah.
Because we all will be here for a while.
Finally. He's been waiting, and he was patient. And the 15th is a good time.
Cool. Oh, God. Now I feel on the spot. Now I don't know if I'm the... I feel like I've in all the other podcasts, I've sprinkled in. The entire episode of what I want this one to be.
That's why I didn't tell you.
Okay, guys.
And it also allows him to talk more than myself because I'm going to be busy.
Let's talk about working out. Let's talk about making gains. Making gains, okay? I've been working out for a little bit. You probably can't tell because of my chicken arms, but I don't work out to be big and bulky and stronger than other people. I work out because it makes me feel good. So let me tell you about my story of working out.
It'll just be loud in the beginning when I'm... Because... Go ahead.
So I started working out about 3 years ago. And what got me started was I wanted to have abs and muscles and I wanted all the girls to fawn over me. So I started going. And then, let me tell you, that motivation dwindles out pretty quickly. You start...
Yeah, for most people.
Yeah, you start putting value on like, I actually prefer cheesesteaks over this. But then when you work out enough, you get to this turning point where your motivation changes. You're no longer saying, I want to look good at the beach. The reason why you keep going is because, one, you made a habit. which is really good. I'll get to that. But two, you start seeing personal growth. So what starts as, I want to lift 400 pounds, and then you go there and you're only lifting 12. What keeps you there is that the next week you realize you're lifting 15. The next week you realize you're lifting 17. And then you get addicted to that always doing better. And then it becomes not this physical, oh, look how good I look in the mirror. It becomes this personal achievement. Like, you see yourself growing and becoming better. And you, if you stick with it, the mindset should just be, I'm always better than the day before. And so that mindset sort of pushed me into a bunch of other things where I started realizing, because in so much of my life before this, I'd get these huge spurts of energy and then I'd lose it. And it was this yo-yo effect. And that doesn't last. That doesn't last for anything. So then you end up burning out. And so then I started just to take this approach of things of just do a little bit every day. Do more than you did yesterday. And then in the long run, it'll pay off. So at this time, you know, I was in college and the first thing was my room was a mess. And I would never have the motivation to clean it because I'm like, it's like a whole day job. And then I started using this workout mindset. I said, hold on. If every day I just clean just a little bit more, then I make a mess. So if I bring one bowl into my room with, you know, it had Cheetos in it, and I take out two plates, the way math goes.
And you're good with math.
I'm good with math. You know, plus two minus one. I know that's plus one. Doesn't matter if it takes long, eventually you will have cleaned your whole room. And then so that sort of, then I started waking up a little earlier. I'm like, if I wake up a little, like, people after a while were like, oh, Spencer, you wake up at 5:30. I could never do that. So instead I'm going to wake up at 11 a.m. And I said, I didn't start waking up at 5:30. I was waking up at 1 p.m. and then I woke up at 12 p.m.
And you know, right, I didn't start out lifting.
Exactly. You know. For a week. And then you know, the next week, I started waking up at 11 p.m. Or 11 p.m. 11 a.m. And it's just, I turned everything into a gradual process. And then I sort of just started getting my whole life in order just on all these fundamentals that came from this idea that working out taught me, which is just consistency and discipline beat out huge spurts of energy any day. And so I read the Bible, as we just state in the entire every podcast. I read the Bible straight through, and it was just that same mindset. It was not, let me read this Bible while I have energy. It was, I go to the gym every day, I'm going to read a couple pages of the Bible every day, and eventually I'm going to finish. It's just the way things work. I just turn all into this discipline. So working out has taught me just in life, the value in long-term success. And I think it works on a spiritual scale too. It made me feel a lot more spiritual, because a lot of people, especially in prayer, they have this mindset of like, they'll ask for something grandiose. And it's sort of the equivalent of going to the gym and wanting to leave with abs.
Right.
And patience. Exactly. And so people lose faith and they say, oh, well, you know, why isn't God answering your prayers? And it's like, he is. When you're going to the gym, you are working, like you're doing things, but things take time and it takes persistency and discipline. And so
now, before you saw the physical differences, were you seeing mental differences?
Yeah. Yeah. And that's sort of what I stated. It was that, like, if you go into it just every day looking for the physical differences, mm-hmm. I promised you, you will stop going to the gym after 2 weeks. But if you're writing down, I lifted this much this week, you're going to see a difference.
Yeah.
Like, and I'm not talking, but don't look at the scale, because that's, I can get into the science of it, but there's so many indicators of what goes into, like, weight on a scale. But yeah, you should gauge it on how you're feeling and stuff.
Yeah.
And then on top of that, now, so every time I go to the gym, I look in the mirror and I don't look any differently to me, because you get used to the subtle differences. But if I look at myself 1 year ago, 2 years ago, 3 years ago, that's when you see the change. And I think it's important with prayer to not be downtrodden and say, God didn't answer my prayers for, blah, blah, blah.
Right.
You should just have this discipline and this day-to-day thing. And it might not feel any different. But then 3 years down the line, after this consistency, you're going to look back and you're going to say, oh, wow, look how much my life did change. Trust the process, like the Sixers.
Yeah.
You just got to
see their new uniforms.
Yeah, disappointment. Yeah,
Yeah,
I saw that. But we wanted the old uniforms.
I saw a lot of people want. I don't know, but I read 2001 is the
thing. Yeah, it's like the Iverson with like the black and red.
Okay.
Yeah, but like, and I just never get that. Like, it's marketing, right? Like, it's not. It's any sort of special uniform and stuff is marketing,
right?
So why are you not appeasing the mat? Like, why is there this constant thing of fans being disappointed? It's like, who is in that office meeting being like, okay, we're designing the uniforms, and there's just like muffling out. Okay, well, this is what people want, but I got my marketing degree at UPenn.
StubHub on it. Do you think maybe they?
StubHub, no. Since Nike bought the contract to make the NBA uniforms,
mm-hmm.
part of the clause is that, like in soccer, every team has a advertiser.
Mm-hmm.
And the Sixers is StubHub, so
that's
not to do with it. But yeah, I just don't get it. All right, but yeah.
Trust the process, which is a Philadelphia 76ers kind of mantra.
Yeah.
They have a new uniform, but you were saying to actually trust the process.
Trust the process. Discipline and long-term goals are what you need, like is the sort of the mindset you need to have in working out. Like, I implore you to work on yourself spiritually, and I implore you to work on yourself physically. Like, and that's where, I can go in a million different paths. That's what we're talking about next.
Okay.
First section done. Second section.
And guess what? First section done.
Second section.
Sort of, some,
Oh, cool. Second section. Being in physical shape. I think this is very important. There's, some intense, like, monks and stuff who give up all possessions and they just devote themselves to just prayer, and they don't have time for money or for, self, like, working on your muscles and stuff.
Right.
They're at Bernathan in the new church. I had a class, and they were talking about this. And it made me like it a lot, because, I'm not the type to want to give up everything. Like, it just doesn't seem right to me. But they have this idea of sharpening the axe. And so if you want to cut trees down, first you sharpen the axe. And so what they were sort of getting at was, you should always be working on yourself, because then you can give more. Like, don't feel like you need to give away. Like, you don't need to make a lot of money in life. I give away all my possessions. It's like, if you are very wealthy, that means you can help that much more. That's right. Obviously, if you're being selfish with it, it's one thing. But don't think, I know it says, it's easier for a nail to go through a something than a rich man to go to heaven. But I think that's more of like when you put too much value on material wealth. But in general, you shouldn't be ashamed of wanting to make a lot of money. Wanting to be in the best physical shape.
Of course. I mean, look at, you just bought a plane ticket,
mm-hmm.
and you said, I'll take the emergency exit seat, because mm-hmm. you get more, leg room and hopefully more distance for COVID. But it asked, are you strong enough to help everybody else on this plane?
Yeah, exactly. So you should be the better you are financially, physically and stuff, the more opportunities you will have to help others. And so I think it's very important. And so you should, we are given a body, and we should push it to its limits and make it be the best usable body itself. And on this topic of the way you look, I want to talk about vanity for a second.
Okay.
Because I've been called vain before.
I mean, isn't a gym 45 minutes of admiring yourself in the mirror?
Yeah, I go for an hour and it's...
Am I wrong?
45 minutes of the mirror.
Well, I mean, the mirror is in front, but is that just to watch your form?
Yeah. Okay. Well, yeah. Just to watch your form and your sick biceps. Vanity. I want to talk about vanity because I've been accused of maybe being a little vain. I like mirrors because the reflection is so darn pretty.
It's good to be confident.
But guess what? This is the way I spun it. I don't know if maybe I just spun this just to justify my actions. But here's my thing. God made us in his image.
That's right.
And so I don't... So I think if you think of it in that way, you can sort of understand it more. Now, obviously, yeah, you shouldn't be egotistical. You shouldn't say, look how perfect I am. But if you're proud of the way you look, yes, especially if you worked on it, and it's like you were literally created in God's image.
Yes.
And so you're using that image and you're proud of it. I think confidence is such an important thing. And
you would have a beautiful garden and be proud, mm-hmm, of what,
yeah,
how you worked on it and you, mm-hmm, changed it.
Yeah, but just especially in this sense where it's like, you know, you're not looking at like something you created. You're looking at God's image,
yeah,
that you have,
that's
used.
True.
And so I think everyone should be a little vain in that sense. Not in the sense of I look so much better than other people, but I think you should be proud of the way you look. God created you with his paintbrush over here. He was here and he painted you.
You're going to like the way you look.
I guarantee it. And so, yeah, so I think, you know, it doesn't matter what size, shape, anything that you are, you should be proud of the way you looked. God created you in his image, okay?
So that's interesting from a gym guy to say that. You just said any size you are, you should be proud. So you're not a judgmental, like...
No,
So that's beautiful that you would say that.
Absolutely. That's the thing. It's... Every human being is created in God's image. And so everyone is beautiful. What you do with that is fine. Like, I choose to push myself and do these little things, but it doesn't make me any more in God's image, right? Like, look, like, people think, like, oh, God's image. But you realize that means, like, that's all of us. Like we're all in,
right,
his image. Not just, like, If you look like this, if you're this color, if you're this size. No, we're all made in God's image. And so you should be confident in that. And for me, that's what, like, it just gives me more motivation. It's like, oh, shoot. Like, sky's the limit. You know what I mean? Like, I'm created in the image of God. I'm going to put it to the test. I'm going to push my body. And then you just become more proud of it. But what else? What else can we talk about with working out? How about just that? Like, just like, use God's image. God gives us power to push ourselves and to do things. So when I'm working out, I call on that power, and I. It's one of these things. When David fought Goliath. David, before he fought Goliath, he was met with a lion, I think, on a path somewhere, and he conquered him, and he was met with a bear. I don't know. There was, like, two things, and then before he met Goliath, and, like, God put these obstacles in front of him.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's sort of, like, the same thing. Like, God gives, even when you don't need it in, like, your ultimate whatever you come to, it's just, I think it's important to know that you always have that power, not just during tribulation.
Right.
And you should be strengthened and harnessing that power. And so that's like the, I think everyone in some way, even if it's intellectually, physically, whatever it is, you should be pushing the limits of the power in which God gives you so that when roadblocks do come and stuff, it's like, this is nothing. Like, I know how powerful I am. And God's what gives me that strength. He's what got me this far, right, going through this, that, or the third. And so, yeah, I think, you know, so we shouldn't really be waiting for something to come up where it's like, okay, God, now give me strength. It's like, God gives you strength even when you don't need it. You know what I mean? Like, I'm at the gym just on a daily basis. God, give me strength. And he does. And I work on that strength. You know, it's like, it's sort of an appreciation, I think. It's like, thank you for giving me the strength. I promise you, I'm not going to waste it. I'm going to use it. I'm going to push myself. I'm going to try to be the best version of me. Cause I think that's a big, you know, like, we're all made in different shapes, sizes. You know, you might be born without an arm, without eyesight. Doesn't matter. Like I said, we're all in his image. And so you shouldn't look at other people and say, I want to look like that. What you should do is, I want to be the best version of me. I want to be better than I was yesterday. You shouldn't be looking in the mirror. Because, yeah, I think that's what keeps you at the gym. It's not, if you're looking at Arnold Schwarzenegger and it's like, I want to look like him, I want to look like him, you're going to be disappointed. But if you change your mindset to say, I want to be better than I was yesterday. You know, I want to read more than I did yesterday.
Yeah.
I want to walk more than I did yesterday. If you're pushing yourself on your own basis, sky's the limit. And I think that's what you need to do. Actually, you know, it's probably better to look in the mirror. You say it's vanity. It's like, there's only one person I want to improve. You know, I'm not looking around saying, oh, that person needs to do that. That person needs to do that. Because I don't like that. I don't like when you look at other people and say, oh, you need to believe this. You need to weigh that much. I'm worried about one person. And that's the person in the mirror. And I want the best for them. And I want to be better than I was yesterday. Every time.
Mm-hmm.
Everything I do during the day is just because I'm a little bit better than I was yesterday. And then that's the
goal. How do you stay motivated? You must come up against days where you...
Pre-workout.
Spencer!
I take enough pre-workout...
Spencer.
To knock a horse out. No, I'm just kidding. No, what I use to stay motivated is just, it's so many things. Like, okay, that's why it's hard. I'm always like on a different motivation. Like right now, I'm going to Florida in 2 weeks. And so I'm pushing a little harder just because my vanity is peaking out. And I'm like, there's going to be beaches. But no. Overall, in general, it's just always, it's sort of an addiction. Like, once you discover this bettering of yourself, because like for so many years, I didn't start really working out until I was in college. It's just sort of like I was letting my life run itself.
Mm-hmm.
And so I would look at, you know, models and stuff and say, wouldn't it be nice? Almost like if I was born with that. Even though they weren't, you just have this thought in the back of your head. Right. Like, oh, if I had abs, oh, that'd be great. If I did this, that'd be great. But once, even if it's on a small scale, you see how much control you have over your own life. Because I think that's also a big deal about the gym, is like, it's one of these things, it opens your eyes to how much control over your destiny and your life that you have. And so when you see yourself, like, look where I am. Or if like you're like, because this is a thing I always think. I'm like, there's two different futures for Spencer right now. In a year, I can, like, if I'm not motivated to go to the gym, I'll be like, in a year, I'll either be exactly where I am right now, and I'll say, wow, that year flew by. I should have just went to the gym.
Mm-hmm.
Or I'm going to be really proud of myself for sticking to it. And so many times, you know, time just rolls by, and then you're always thinking back, like, wow, if I actually stuck with that 2 years ago, I would have been going to the gym for 2 years now.
Yeah.
I probably would have looked great. And it's like, I think sort of doing that for so long, I got tired of it, and I'm like, and so then, yeah, then you get addicted to that improvement, and then you, like, it's rapid. Once you start looking in the right places, and you're not looking at, like, things like what the scale is saying, right, and this. But when you start looking at how you're feeling, your physical strength growing, you get addicted. You're like, wow, like I'm, like, nothing feels better than in genuinely improving yourself. Because you're like, wow, I, and you're proud of you. Wow, I did that. That That was me. But yeah.
Now, I know that you do gym, you do rock climbing, you do outdoor running. I don't know if you bike.
My bike broke.
Do you feel closer to God when you're in the park than
yes.
you do?
Yes. There is something about nature that is very humbling and also can get you closer to God. I think what it is we live in such a man-made world. And so it's very easy to put man at the head of it. Like right now, we're in an entirely built room of electronics and all these things. And you're like, this is great. I'm living the life. And it's easy to sort of forget, kind of forget about God.
Mm-hmm.
But when you're running on a trail and you look up and the sun's just shooting through the windows, it's a very...
Shooting through the windows?
Oh, sorry. I'm looking at the window.
Where's your trail?
Shooting through the trees. And it's like sometimes you just look up and you're like, wow. Like you take in all the beauty and you become more thankful for everything. And also pushing yourself physically, you get a runner's high.
Mm.
And it's this very natural sort of euphoric feeling of... And then you instead of like getting so like downtrodden and stuff, it's this completely other headspace that you can get into, and then you can feel that much more spiritual in doing that. And I remember I was going. This was like when I was still in college. I was at my college gym and it has a big window in the back, and I was going to the gym pretty early then. I think I was getting to the gym at 5, and I would run 2 miles. On the treadmill, because it was like during winter. But then I'd go stretch out on the mat, but like sort of it was just timed out that every time I stretched on the mat, the sunrise came and just like flooded in this orange light.
That's nice.
Into the whole gym, because it was like a real small gym. And yeah, it was always like a spiritual, a meditative, all these things experience. And let me tell you, that those days were hard. Like even for people who are really into working out,
mm-hmm.
getting out of bed at 4:45 in the dead of winter was tough. And but let me tell you, I think it's another thing to talk about working out is sort of short-term pain for long-term rewards. Those were the best days I had after that. So what I would do, this was also when I was reading the Bible, I would go to the gym at 5. I would get home, clean my room, then I'd take a shower. Then at 7, I would read some of the Bible before my 8 a.m. class. I'd get to my 8 a.m. class, and you can imagine after all that, especially the shower, and I'm wide awake, I'm in a great mood. All of the sort of the hardest parts of my day were done.
Right.
And then there would be kids in the class, nothing wrong with it, but I was that kid for so long. But it's like, don't talk to me. I haven't had coffee. Like, and it's like rubbing their eyes. They're in their PJs and stuff. And I was hyper. I was up. And something about starting your day with a little bit of struggle, a little bit of pushing yourself makes the rest of the day. And then like, it would be like, I'd be with a person. We'd have the exact same situation and they would like... this day's just getting worse and worse. And like, it wouldn't even faze me, you know, if like in a surprise test or something. It's like, you're sort of in this good mood from pushing yourself.
Right.
And, I think that's another important thing. Like I try to be I think it sort of goes off of what I was saying about David, but you can get through any obstacle through God, but I always like to be my hardest obstacle.
Mm.
I push it on myself. And so for so long, I wouldn't get out of bed until my first, whether it was work or a class or a meeting.
Right.
That is what dictated when I'm getting out of bed. And then when I started waking up early, nothing was early to me. Like, people were saying, oh my God, this 8 a.m. class is too early. I'm like, that's not really like I'm not going to allow for life to dictate what I do. I want to be in charge of my life.
Right.
Like I want to push myself harder than life will push me. And I think then it makes life easy.
So do you think that exercise has made you a better Christian, or do you think being a Christian has made you a better athlete?
Exercise has made me a better Christian.
Okay.
Yeah. I think.
And why is that? Gratitude or
all of
inspiration?
The, yeah, all of the above. I think just like what I was just going off on is mm-hmm. is this, you sort of let the day run you and all these things. And sort of once you feel control over your body and you realize how much you can do,
mm-hmm.
I feel like only really then are you able to dive into more spirit. Like
your potential?
Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. It's like, oh, wow. Like I'm not on autopilot anymore. Like I have the ability to do all these things. And then you can sort of, you know, if you are on this autopilot of like, I am the way I am, blah, blah, blah. But it's whatever. But if you do start pushing yourself and you're like, oh, like, oh, God's given me all this strength. Like, and then you are like, if you, like you're praying during this time.
Right.
But the difference is you're putting work into, like, you're sort of like working with God. Like,
right.
Oh God, like give me the strength to go to the gym. Like give me the strength. And then you're putting out the strength. Then you're starting seeing things rather than being passive. And right. It's like, well, there is what it is. And then you sort of see how much further you can go with you giving your all and asking God to help you with it.
Right.
Because, you know, if you don't go through any obstacle, like I think that's like I've said this before, is it's better for people who like go through obstacles to be able to get closer to God. Mm-hmm. because that's like sort of when you see it the most. It's like he's always there for you. But, and then, you know, that's like sort of when sometimes people only pray is like, hey, I'm going through this.
Right.
And so then it limits your prayer. But if you're putting yourself through these obstacles for yourself, then you're constantly calling on God. Right. And he's constantly, you know, picking up the phone. He's answering. And so, yeah, if you're going through your comfortable life, you know, because I have a pretty comfortable life. And if it's like you never have sort of that. It's like you'd pray at night, like, oh, thank you, blah, 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 blah.
Yeah.
But I feel like it's just more.
Yeah. And it's always good to have successes.
Yeah.
And it's hard in life, especially so many things might be stopping you from just seeing full success, you know,
yeah.
However you define that, but still. So I can imagine that little goals that you set, maybe if a little bit more weight or you ran a little further or mm-hmm. you climbed a little higher, they must be great, you know, to build, just to build you up in these little ways that come together as big ways. You know, you don't have to climb Mount Everest.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah, we talked about in the cleanliness podcast, but just the making your bed in your morning. Like I know it's that Navy SEAL who wrote the book about it and just talked about it, but I think it rings so true in working out.
Happy Veterans Day.
Happy Veterans Day.
Now that you say that. It's the 11th. It's 11/11.
Make a wish.
Which is very, very magical number. Sorry. Hope you remember. Will you remember?
Yeah, I'll remember.
Okay. And his birthday is 11, so you're a very magical person. And so also on our 15th anniversary. Go ahead.
The 15th anniversary. yeah. So what this Navy SEAL talked about was just making your bed in the morning. You've already, the first obstacle of your day, you've accomplished. You've accomplished something before
right.
you even start your day. And then like he goes on. He's like a nice speech. I recommend listening to it. Mm-hmm. But the idea, the whole thing goes is like, once you start your first obstacle, all the rest will be easier because you're already set, like putting yourself on a good foot. But then, you know, say your day goes terribly, you come home to a made bed, and it's just like, and you know that's a good feeling. It's just the same way with working out. Like, I think it's important to have these successes, and a lot of stuff in life we don't have control over. You know, if you get randomly fired from your job.
Yeah.
Blah, blah, blah.
Unexpected.
And it's like.
Or a breakup.
Yeah. Yeah. Anything of just sort of like that just comes to you, you have no control over, can really bring you down.
Someone breaks into your car.
So I think it's just so important. There's one thing that we have full. You might think you own your house, but someone can break into it. You might think that that the person you're with is you know, your other half, and they might be, you know,
right,
pulling two-timers on, I don't know how to say that.
You might think
two-timing you.
You might think you ordered the right drink at Starbucks, and
they give you the wrong one.
And they give you the wrong one. Happened to me yesterday.
There's one thing that you do have control over, and that's your body. So that's what makes it so important to have that, like have those successes. Because that is one thing. Your body's never going to turn on you and say, your body's not going to break up with you.
And that is
thank you for coming to the
of the day.
No, but yes, you know what I'm saying. It's just like,
yeah,
it's the one thing you have. You were created in God's image. He gave you your body. And so I think making the most of it is a very rewarding feeling. And it should be cherished.
It should, yeah.
And it's tough. I mean, it's tough, but it's worth it. It's tough to eat healthy. I hate eating healthy. I've been doing it for a while, but...
No, but you hate... I don't know if you should say you hate it.
Okay.
Because
if I hated it, I wouldn't do it.
You're getting so used to it
yeah.
that now when you... when or so he told me that when you eat unhealthy food, you're like affected by the high amount of sodium or whatever.
It affects my body. But, yeah, I think that's sort of what I'm trying to say is it's tough, but it's sort of it's these long-term goals. If at night, which I do still constantly, probably like once a week, I'll get a cheesesteak and wings and a soda, and I'll eat them all within an hour.
Mm-hmm.
And I wake up the next day and I just feel terrible. And I'm like, and the worst part about it is the food's gone. It's not even like, I hate spending money on like food because it's like, the food disappears and then you're not even happy. The only point that was worth it is in that 1 hour of you eating it.
Yeah.
And then your body's not appreciative. Your wallet's not appreciative. Nothing's appreciative. Where in the alternative, if you eat healthy food, at first, at the time, you're like, man, this isn't a cheesesteak. But then the next day, you're feeling great.
Yeah.
Like, all these different things. And I always say this is it's always like, if you just get yourself to the next morning, my worst cravings come at night. And I always say, Spencer, just go to sleep and wake up. And 9 times out of 10, if I don't cheat, if I don't slip, I wake up and I'm so happy with myself. I'm like... Because I'm not even craving it anymore. It's just sort of these nighttime cravings.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm like, if I had eaten that cheesesteak right now, I would be in a bed. Like, I never woke up the next day and said, still glad I did that last night.
No.
Unless, you know, it's an... I try to keep my junk food eating and stuff added with another, like, only as a combined experience. Like, if I'm going out with friends or anything, I don't... Like, I guess I'm trying to get at it. I try not to be too hard on myself. Like... Another thing about working out is don't be too hard on yourself if you slip up. Because once again, like it doesn't benefit you. Even if you tried to go to the gym and four times during a year and you just can't keep it up, don't be too hard on yourself because you gave the effort. So when I do have, you know, a big old plate of wings, I try. I mean, I'm not always successful, but I try to just be like enjoy the moment. You shouldn't be like beating yourself up over it. Because I started working out and eating healthy for my own happiness, and so if I am happy and I'm eating wings, it's like I'm defeating the purpose by then being so hard on myself for screwing it up.
And Jesus said that. Doesn't matter what you eat because it's going to go in and it's going to come out. It doesn't matter what goes in your mouth. It matters what comes out of your mouth.
Mm-hmm.
And that's your words. So you never should really beat yourself up, but you should feel proud of what you're eating. I remember when I was pregnant, I would be so happy when I would eat healthy because I would feel like that was so nice of me to give it to the baby. And then I would say to myself years later, like, why don't I care about this person?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
It's still important. It's still, give yourself something.
Yeah, that's the thing. It's like, you're doing yourself, it might not feel like it at the time, but you're doing yourself a favor. Like, you're rewarding your body. Like, your body does a lot for you, and it's easy for your mind and body to be at odds with each other.
Right.
And it's like, you should be doing, and that's sort of, with the working out. It's like, I have this body that I was given. I do have, cravings and laziness and stuff, but overall, I try to do my best to, because I am thankful for my body.
And it's self-control, and is practicing self-control. Yeah, so
no, that's a whole nother thing about it. Is
it always lets you say...
It's challenging yourself.
It's challenging yourself, but having the success so that you...
Yeah.
You know, when people go, I can't do it. If you have anything to look back on, like, wait a second. I do remember that I walked all the way to the post office or something. You know, these little things give you, like, okay, I can do it. I've done this, you know?
Yeah, exactly. You don't want to just go through life, like I said, letting life control you. Any craving, habit. It's like... Any little bit of discipline goes a long way because it just pushes your boundaries of what you can do.
Right.
And so, yeah, it's not about what other people do. It's about what you can do. And it can be a so small scale. Like, one walk, a single lap around the block. And
that's right.
Like, you accomplish a goal for yourself. And that's what life's all about, right? It's just pushing yourself.
And like, everyone's journey's different. So, if you can't go around the block, can you stand up?
Yeah.
From your chair?
Yeah.
Or can you just, instead of 5 sodas a day, 4 sodas a day, so
yeah,
same thing.
That's always what I
instead
preach.
Of praying 5 times a day, can you pray 1 time a day? You
know? It's just, you're in competition with yourself.
Right.
The only person, so I tell everyone, be better than you were yesterday. But that's not be better than that person was yesterday. It's be better than you were yesterday. On the smallest scale, by numbers, doesn't matter what you're doing. If you weigh... 800 pounds, shoot for 795. Don't look at someone and say, oh, that person's 140 pounds. That's what I want to be like.
Right.
Set goals for yourself. And I always say a lot of things, don't I? I always say, when it comes to diets, I'm going to talk about diets briefly. I don't know how long we want this podcast to
run. Because I'm just going to keep painting, and I don't know if I'm making it worse, okay. Which is what happens with artists.
All right, I'll wrap it up. But
no, it's fine.
With diet... I always say this. People love to crash diet. It's sort of the gym's equivalent of going in and expecting to leave with abs.
Yeah.
People love to get, maybe it's like New Year's, or and they're like, New Year's resolution, I'm losing weight.
Yeah.
And they drop.
Well, it's because you want it fast.
Yeah. They drop all carbs. They drop all this. They don't have no sugar whatsoever. Yada yada. And let me tell you something, it's not going to work. And it doesn't need to be like that. So remember, I'm a numbers guy, okay? And people will give you a million ways to lose weight. They'll tell you a million different biological things to make you lose weight. Don't eat at night, go into ketosis, intermittent fast. And all these things can work, but... I'm going to tell you, it's thermodynamics. Calories in versus calories out. That's it. You need to be, to lose weight, you need to be putting less calories into your body than calories are being burned a day. The average calories that people burn is 2,000. But everyone, you should calculate your own calories. It's all based on weight, amount of activity you do, gender and age. But... So people go on these crash diets, and it's like, you don't need to be doing that. Like, if right now, so many people that like I'm friends with, they will say, I need to go on a diet, and they'll stop eating everything. I'm like, I could, and then they're like, I'm starving, they're going through their day, and
they don't want to stick with it.
They're so hungry, and then they give up, and I'm like, there's so many people, I could literally cut a few things out of their diet plan. And that's all they wouldn't be anymore. They wouldn't be any more hungry, because that's the thing. Unless you're like gaining weight rapidly, it usually means you're at a pretty level point of calories in versus calories out. So instead of dropping any of the foods you like during the day, if you just maybe like you drink a soda with every meal, 3 sodas, you're at 900 calories. Drop just the sodas. Drink water instead. you're already down that many calories without even changing your food diet. Right. And there's just so many little things like that where it's just like, I don't know how that relates to spirituality, but...
Well, it does, because when you're talking, I'm thinking, when you just said, you know, when people go into it on January 2nd, they say, I'm gonna stop this, I'm gonna do that, I'm gonna work every day. It, well, it's the same thing with when people are reborn or rediscover God, or... Because we're not talking about children, we're talking about adults who've decided to go a spiritual path.
Yeah.
Sometimes they go, I'm never going to curse, and I'm not going to watch any R-rated movies, yeah. and I'm going to pray this many times a day. I'm going to go to church on Sunday and Wednesday. That, it's not sustainable. It's just like the guy at the gym. I mean, yeah. Give yourself a chance.
Yeah.
You can't go from zero to 100 successfully.
Exactly. And in the same way I say, I could show this person how to go on a diet, just like drop a few sodas, mm-hmm. instead of, and then I promise you, you're going to be in,
yeah.
in more of a, you're going to be doing better for yourself. Same thing. It's like, we'll just pray once a day, you know, and yeah. it's like, start there. Cause then I always try to get people in this mindset, cause that gets you into this trickle effect. Like,
right.
once you become used to, you know, less, then you can start going tricking away and away and away until you are doing really great. Like if anyone tries to follow someone else of where they're at, then without going what they've gone through to get there,
right.
you're going to be burnt out. You know what I mean? Like, if I go up against Usain Bolt on a sprint, I can say I want to run the camp as much as I want, but until I put in the time and energy, and probably had the genetics, but that's besides the point.
Oh yeah.
And that's the thing. Everyone literally, like, it's not just, oh, we're all different. We're like snowflakes. No, like, we're physically built different. Like,
yeah.
Every person's genetics are differently.
No, that's true. I was listening to girls on Instagram about that. They go to school for physical science.
Yeah.
What's it called? Athletic science or whatever.
Yeah. It's physical.
Well, they do that. And they were saying, if anyone ever tells you that this exercise or this program is going to make you like longer and leaner, or, well... you have bones and things that are going to make that not a true statement. Yeah. So.
I was just looking into it about the amount of different types of abs guys have.
Mm-hmm.
And people look for like Hollywood abs, and it's like, but they might have these like, you know, four small abs and nothing on the left. And it's like, it's just so many different things. It's like, it's not just about, oh, I want to look like that person. Like, we're all physically, but that's what I'm saying. You can only make you the best version of you.
Right.
You can never be someone else. You can never have someone else's body, have someone else's hairline. You're you. And so make you the best.
Right.
Best version of you. And that's all you need to do.
And you know what's the best version?
Which one?
This. I'm ready.
All right. Well, that's... let's.
Is it going to be out of focus?
You can put it up. I'll lift it up to the camera. So I'll sign...
It's wet.
Okay, that's fine. All right, guys. Thank you for listening to my spiel. I was on a little bit of a soapbox there.
No,
but
you were waiting for this. It was your time to shine.
And I'm sure I will bring it up a lot more. But yeah. And if anyone wants this painting, you can have it. But yeah, so we'll be back tomorrow. Probably no special. We gave away like 3 special surprises today.
I know.
So tomorrow is going to be bland.
Yeah. Don't expect too much. I mean,
tomorrow is going to be bland. Tomorrow's going to be vanilla.
Every day's not Christmas.
Every day's not Christmas. But yeah, so painting, look forward to the van build in the future. And it's been real. Let me just give them a close up to your.
It's wet.
That's fine.
It's very wet. Okay. Please don't let it fall forward on your keyboard. It's a croak and a crow. There you go. Yeah.
Okay. Croak and crow. There you go. All right, y'all. Peace.